As we saw in the last video, two different coordinate systems that are connected by a rotation can have very different values for coordinates, but the same distance between two coordinates. We say that this distance is an invariant, and that means that people in different coordinate systems will still agree on something. In this case, it's that the square root of the sum of the squares of the coordinate differences is the same, whether you're in the primed frame or the unprimed frame. We can also say these two coordinate systems are connected by a rotational transformation, and we can write that if this is our setup here. X prime is equal to x plus co or x prime is equal to x cosine theta plus y sine theta, and y prime is equal to negative x sine theta plus y cosine theta. It would be a pretty quick exercise to square this, the x prime and the y prime, add them together and take the square root. And using the trig identities, we'd see we get the same thing. We get, if we put in the x prime and y prime, sum of the squares of the coordinates, and take the square root, we'd get the sum of the squares of the unprimed coordinates. We can write a similar 3D set of equations to go between x, y, z coordinates to x prime, y prime, z prime coordinates. This is kind of an ugly mess, and it's the main reason that last semester you probably only did collisions in two dimensions at most. It's not that the physics is much different, it's just that this rotational stuff is really kind of a pain. If you're interested, the thing to look up is Euler angles. Now, observers in the primed and unprimed coordinates systems can again disagree about coordinate values, but they have to agree on lengths. Just as in the 2D case, and we calculate them with the 3D version of the Pythagorean theorem. So we just add square root, we add the square of the other coordinate. So we've got x squared plus y squared plus z squared, we take the square root of that. It's the same as x prime squared plus y prime squared plus z prime squared. Now, if you think about what shapes are unchanged when these rotations are made, in 2D, if you rotate either way, whichever way you go, however much you rotate it, a circle looks the same. In 3D, a sphere looks the same no matter how you rotate it. What would be the equivalent thing in 4D space-time? If we think about that for a while, it turns out we can imagine a flash of light at the origin of coordinates at time equals zero expanding outward in all directions at speed c, the speed of light. We know the radius as a function of time can be expressed as r equals c delta t. We could also write that as r squared equals c delta t squared. We can plug in what we found above for distance and get delta x squared plus delta y squared plus delta z squared is c delta t squared. This doesn't necessarily seem to have a point right now, but we could also take this c delta t squared over to the other side of the equation and write it like this. What this is leading to is something called the interval. In ordinary 2D and 3D geometries, the thing that doesn't change when you rotate to different coordinate systems is length. So we can write it with the 2D Pythagorean theorem or the 3D Pythagorean theorem. If we want to incorporate time, we do have to fix the units because we can't add squared meters to squared seconds and get anything that makes sense. That's where the C comes in to turn that time into a distance. The thing that would sort of make sense if we wanted to extend this to 4D would be just to add this c delta t squared under the radical. We could stick with the same formula in 20 dimensions or 400 dimensions or whatever, and we would still get the same extension of the Pythagorean theorem. We would just keep adding squares of coordinates. This is what's called Euclidean space, and that's almost certainly all you learned about in high school geometry. The standard 2D geometry you do there is on a flat sheet of paper. The universe, it turns out, is not 4D Euclidean space-time. In special relativity, what we have instead is called Minkowski space-time. Minkowski was actually one of Einstein's professors. Here, instead of using the length, we extend the Pythagorean theorem a different way. We have the interval. We define the square of the interval as this sum of the squares of the space coordinates. But we subtract the square of the time coordinate, and that minus sign makes all the difference. In ordinary, high school geometry, the only way you get a zero distance between two points is if they're the same point, because the length formula is the sum of squares and it has no negative pieces. Minkowski space-time doesn't work like that. If we have events connected by a light pulse, we could say we have the origin, or we have the flash at the origin at t equals 0, and then it gets absorbed 300,000 kilometers away in the x direction 1 second later, the interval between them is 0. The length between them is certainly not 0. It's 300,000 kilometers, and the time is not 0. It's 1 second. But this combination would give us 0 in that case. Any two events that are separated by a 0 interval like this, we call them light-like separated. In other words, only light could connect the two. On the other hand, what if two events are you stand up and then you open the door to whatever room you're sitting in? It'll take you at least a second to get to from the chair to the door, and the room you're in is definitely less than the distance light travels in a second, about 300,000 kilometers. So in our interval formula, we'll have a much bigger time piece, which is the negative part, remember, than a space piece, which is going to be, you know, a couple of meters. That means the interval itself is actually negative, and we call it time-like. Time-like events have a fixed order, and the earlier one can influence the later one, but it doesn't have to. No one traveling in any reference frame will claim that you opened the door before you stood up, and there is a causality relationship there. You had to get up first before you could close the door. The third category is where we have a spatial separation that's greater than the time separation. We call these space-like intervals, and that means two events can't be linked causally. That's not causally. For example, the moon is about 400,000 kilometers from the Earth. If you push a button on the Earth and 0.5 seconds later the moon explodes, could you have caused it? No, because even light couldn't get there that fast. If two events have a space-like interval between them, different observers can see them take place in different time order. Someone traveling at the right speed in the right direction would see the moon explode before they saw you push the button. This is the reason when we think of the experiment when we talked about simultaneity, where the person on the train turns on the light switch and sees the light hit the front and back walls simultaneously, but someone on the track disagrees, this is why. You might at first think it's a light-like interval, since we're talking about the movement of light. And if the two events were the light leaving the bulb and the light hitting one of the walls, that would be a light-like separation. Our two events, though, are the light hitting the front and the light hitting the back. In the train frame, they're simultaneous, so the time separation between them is zero. The distance separation, however, is not zero. It's the length of the train car, 10 meters, whatever. That means the interval must be greater than zero, and that means it's space-like, and that's why we disagree on the time ordering. The person on the train says that they are simultaneous. The person on the track says the back one got hit first. People can disagree on the time order, which boils down to the value of delta t, and the distance components, but all inertial observers have to agree on the interval. It's invariant, and this is just like the way people using rotated coordinate systems can disagree about the pieces, but not the invariant part, which is the length. Now, just as we wrote down equations with sines and cosines that connected prime coordinates to unprime coordinates, we can write down transformation equations between different inertial frames. We want to make this as simple as possible, so we don't want to have to deal with all that Euler angle stuff. The first thing we do is put the coordinate systems in the same orientation. X and X prime point in the same direction, Y and Y prime do, Z and Z prime do. We also want time to line up. These two frames have to be in relative motion, but we can say the instant that they overlap, that's where we set our zero of both t and t prime. So at that instant where the two frames pass through each other, we set both times to zero and all the coordinates are zero for that one instant. We also restrict ourselves to motion along this common x, x prime axis to make it simpler. When we do all that, which is the standard way to do it, we can write these transformation equations. Time in the unprimed frame is related to time and distance in the prime frame and velocity this way. We could use our gamma factor to make them look a lot simpler. We notice that in the perpendicular directions, the directions perpendicular to motion, the y prime, z prime, y and z, nothing changes. There's complete agreement between the rocket going past you and you about distances perpendicular to the direction of motion. We can invert these transformations to find the way to get the prime coordinates from the unprime coordinates two ways. We could go through and solve this system of really two equations, two unknowns. That's all we care about since we don't have to do anything with the y and z. But it's much easier to just swap primes for unprimed coordinates and change the sine of v to minus v. And this is because if somebody says you're moving at v, you would say they're moving at minus v. Now, you could actually take these equations and verify that the interval is the same for prime coordinates and unprime coordinates, just like we talked about doing for the sine and cosine transformations of a 2D rotation. If you do that, you'll see that you get the same thing. You put in these, for example, and find the interval with them, and what you'll get out is the interval written in terms of unprimed coordinates. This is a little bit beyond what you do in an intro class, but it's a very common homework problem in upper-level physics courses where you first start seeing relativity.